Psychology 336, Era of Sociopolitical Systems. To put my students at ease, let me first note one of several errors that I'll be talking about tonight. Your midterm exam begins not tomorrow, but the following week. Week 6, and includes all materials covered through week 6 as was specified in your syllabus. So my sincere apologies, and hopefully you'll get it straight. I'll send another email tomorrow morning just to remind people. Now, welcome Huan Ying to our class on Archaic China. We'll be looking to varying degrees at the four earliest dynasties of ancient China, beginning 2000 AD with the Xia dynasty, which is spelled in English XIA, the Xia dynasty, and following that with the Shang, and then the Zhou, which is spelled Z-H-O-A in English, and finally the Qin dynasty, which is spelled Q-I-N. These four successive dynasties are dated from about 2000 BC to about 200 BC. So the vast majority of the material, and then there'll be some updating towards the end, will deal with a civilization that began and spans a period that ends before the birth of Jesus Christ. Before I get to more errors, at least one more error from last week, I've been asked to read the following usual announcement. This class is part of the Applied Studies Bachelor's Degree Completion Program. Classes are broadcast live on this cable television channel and webcast on the internet each week. This fall, we are broadcasting four classes, this one, Anthropology 336, which is on Tuesdays from 7 to 7:50 p.m. Labor Studies 412, Labor Law, on Saturdays from noon to 1:40 p.m. Communications 365, an Introduction to Public Relations, on Saturdays from 1:50 to 3:30 p.m. And Humanities 310, Theater of Revolt, on Sundays from noon to 2 p.m. If you have completed the first 2 years of college, you can earn a bachelor's degree by enrolling in these classes. All the courses you need to complete your bachelor's degree will be broadcast on this channel during the next 2 years, and then it will start all over again. If you would like more information about the Applied Studies Bachelor's Degree Completion Program, you can deal with the information right here on the lower third, www.appliedstudies.tv or 1-866-278-6789. And now back to mea culpas. Having dealt with the exam, which is during week 6 as specified in the syllabus, we now move to last week, a redux, which is Latin for do-over or continuation. And I have 3 points to make about last week. The first is an error in my off-the-cuff response to a phone question about Julius Caesar and his slaughter in the first big bread and circus event, his slaughter of what I said were lions and Christians. Well, he died before Jesus was born, so he couldn't possibly slaughter Christians. What he did slaughter was hundred for the pleasure of the public. Was gladiators, that's what we like to call it, which is really effectively slaves who are forced to fight to the death and or suffer other torments and be killed in the Colosseum. However, from resurrection of Jesus Christ, for the next 300 years, his descending emperors, the Caesars that followed, slaughtered plenty more lions, plenty more gladiator slash slaves, and untold thousands, there's a huge debate about exactly how many, of gladiator slaves that were Christians. So when I think of lions, I think of Christians in the context of Rome, and I slipped up there. If you want to see an alternative view of Julius Caesar, you can go to the YouTube site and type in Michael Parenti, P-A-R, Parent, E-N-T-I, or type in video, The Assassination of Julius Caesar, for a very interesting alternative minority explanation that casts Julius Caesar in the light of a progressive who wanted to improve upon the lack of democracy in the Republic. Secondly, based on a student query, she wanted to know, with all good reason, where are the women in all this? And so the next thing I want to talk about is the women. And we have a picture. Can we get a closer look at this just for a moment, of this picture here? And you can see there are women here pictured in the fall of Rome, trying to protect their families and being victimized by the barbarians. But the question is, are women just subordinated, non-powerful actors in Rome? Well, the short answer to that is if we hadn't had a glitch, a technical glitch with one of the videos that we showed last week, Eugene Weber talked about the extreme patriarchy, the extreme patriarchy that spanned the whole Roman period from the kingdom through the fall of the empire, in which men absolutely controlled and doled out and decided the futures of their wives and daughters, who he argued were virtually powerless. However, as we might remember when I talked about the evolution of human cultures, when you have class stratified societies, which Rome certainly was, the women in the higher classes, although they're still completely subordinated to the men in their families and the men in that class, certainly have more say about what goes on in society than both men and women in the lower classes. So if you leave women, whether it be Cleopatra in Egypt, or as I'll talk about right now, Livia, the wife of the grand nephew of Julius Caesar and the second emperor of Rome, who became Augustus, his wife, who came to him pregnant with her second child, from her first husband, who was an opponent of Augustus, who divorced her first husband in order to make a political arrangement with the victor Augustus. She made sure that none of Julius Caesar's or her husband's relations became succeeding emperors of Rome. All the succeeding emperors of Rome were related to the two children that she had had with her first husband. So whereas, yes, history is often in the great Western civilization trend, his story, history, Livia presents an example of a great woman in Western civilization who went to all lengths, according to, if you believe, Robert Graves' historical classic novel, I, Claudius, all lengths to make sure that only the offspring of her loins, so to speak, or her womb, would be elevated to emperor after her second husband, Augustus. So she provides her story in the great women of Western civilization that needs to be told. By the way, that clip that was glitched, it also gave the details of my favorite conspicuous consumption creation of vomitoriums, the palaces of Rome. So I always highly recommend that you go to YouTube and watch Eugene Weber's discussion of Rome that we didn't get as much of as we might have wished. Third, I want to recapitulate the aftermath of the fall of Rome briefly, as I just briefly discussed it in a lecture last week. Before I do so, from the audience, I have the following email question. Professor, wasn't Caesar really dictator for life instead of emperor? And Augustus was the first emperor. You may well have me. I don't know. That may well be true. Of course, Caesar became the name for the emperors. They were the Caesars that followed Julius Caesar, and Augustus was a Caesar. And as for the details, not for the first or last time, your professor may know less than you about the nuances of the royal titles. I honestly am not totally sure. If we can get a quick close-up of this sack of Rome, I want to mention a few things. Take a closer look at this picture here behind me. Thank you. The fall of Rome is, as is pictured here, usually thought of as a bad or sad thing, with barbarians torturing the innocent Roman citizens and doing unspeakable things and plundering and all that sort of thing. And that Europe fell into the Dark Ages after the fall of Rome, when largely unwashed barbarians from throughout the former empire had their way and or undermined civilization. Well, a great deal of forensic archaeological evidence has been compiled that says that ain't so. That after the fall of Rome, the people that live throughout the boot of Italy, it was found, got more varied diets, better diets with more different kinds of foods in them, had more egalitarian societies in which people shared communally and lived together, and actually lived longer lives with less infant mortality, less diseases. And this golden age, some have argued, although others say it was a golden age, but this improvement in the lives of ordinary people after the fall of Rome is tied to the lack of a tributary empire system taxing these people beyond their capability to pay. Once Rome fell, and once there wasn't some large empire constantly demanding payments and tribute and or conquering them, the average person lived a longer life, a better life. And this is very interesting to us, of course, because this archaeological evidence of a more egalitarian early Middle Age, that is before the Renaissance, before the return of city-states like Venice and Florence, for example, which developed tributary economies and fought with each other various wars. This was hiatus in the city-state's tributary system fits with a cultural materialist argument. And the model about human, about the evolution of human cultures, that there can actually be ups and downs, and that these can affect people in ways similarly to earlier evidence I provided of foragers living better lives than the early domesticators of plants and animals. So that was the three main points that I wanted to make, the redux of last week. And now we're going to move on to the five main issues I hope to cover tonight, this week, in terms of looking at the archaic first four early dynasties of archaic China. The final is of a Meg-O-O, another early hominid migration controversy. We thought we had gotten beyond this with the peopling of the New World and the Asiatic hypothesis. And then as I was doing my work on China, preparing for this class, I realized there's another controversy about hominid migration that we need to cover. Secondly, there are other issues that, as always, I'm going to cover about migration into China, migration within China, and migration out of China. So that's the second main issue that I want to talk about tonight. The third main issue is to look at the four dynasties beginning 2,000 years before Jesus was born. And providing the argument of the mainstream scholars go, the cultural foundations, these first four dynasties, of what went on to be the most enduring, persisting, long-lasting, single civilization in the history of humanity. So Chinese civilization going back from 2000 BC is traced up to the fall of the last emperor of China in about 1910. So we're looking at, almost 4,000 years of persistent, ongoing Chinese culture. It's more complicated than that, and not nearly as positive as that might sound, just as the fall of Rome wasn't nearly as negative as we've largely been led to believe. And so we'll look at archaeological evidence that persists from these early dynasties. And then we will look at agricultural production. Remember that in all early civilizations, which both the Mexica and the Maya are in Mesoamerica, and not Rome, but China is early civilizations, agriculture is the foundation upon which wealth is produced and usurped through the class structure that we described in week two of states. Feel free to give me a call at 800-339-1193 if you have a question or a comment about what we're talking about. So that's the fourth issue, is agricultural production. And the fifth issue that we want to cover is the complications of this long, enduring, continuous civilization out of China for about 4,000 years. That is the stratification, conflicts, warfare, wealth and wealth expropriation, the spread of trade beyond China and eventually all the way to Europe, and finally, briefly, the long, slow demise of Chinese civilization and the sudden collapse in 1910 with the last emperor. So first, let's revisit the out-of-Africa experience again. And we've got a slide that's going to help us with this. What I talked about earlier, when I talked about out-of-Africa, can we get a close-up, please, of this? In earlier sessions, I talked about out-of-Africa as it pertained to Homo sapiens, which is, of course, modern humans. But what we see here is that there was an, there was an earlier, let me see if I can do that better. There was an earlier flow of hominids out of Africa, that is Homo erectus. And you can see there are a series of different succeeding, more or less, species of hominids that eventually led to Homo sapiens. And the bottom three below the line are only found in Africa. But there have been finds, actually much more extensively than these two that are noted here, of Homo erectus both in Europe and as far away as Indonesia and definitely in China, as we will see. So when we think of human migration, we could only be talking about modern Homo sapiens sapiens. That's a later flow that is represented here. But the reality is that an earlier hominid that led to modern Homo sapiens, Homo erectus, migrated out of Africa as much as 3/4 of a million years time earlier than I might have been led to believe. Primates have been migrating out of Africa, as you might recall from the video clip that we saw session two. Primates migrated out of Africa as much as 10 million years ago. Homo erectus, at least 750,000 years ago. And then, of course, eventually, another flow, Homo sapiens migrating out in the last, now I'm blanking on the period of time, 30 or so thousand years ago into Europe and into the New World about 14,000 years ago, and eventually replacing the Homo erectus that had been there before. Can we see the next stone, okay, please? And let's get a close up of it for a second. This is the skull of what was called Peking Man. I guess nowadays we would call it Beijing Man. This is Homo erectus, and we're going to have a series of slides, but you can see, presumably, that it's a very massive jaw, a very low brow, with actually a larger cranial capacity overall than amongst modern humans. The teeth are all also more massive, the lower jaw is more massive. This is a huge skull compared to modern Homo sapiens sapiens skulls. Next slide, please. And this is just, this shows you the enormous brow ridge of these Homo erectus. Again, it shows the low skull, but it also gives you an indication of how large it is. It has more cc's, what's that, cubic centimeters, than modern day human skulls on average do. Next slide, please. And this gives you the best idea, maybe of all, of the massive brow ridge, the very low skull shape, and its wideness, which is where the larger cc's come in, the larger cranial capacity. Thank you. So these folks migrated out of Africa as much as 750,000 years ago, and remains were found in China. And so we don't want to think that the first hominids, the first ancestors of modern Homo sapiens, were Homo sapiens themselves. The next slide, please. And this shows the museum in Beijing that's devoted to the finds of Peking Man. I guess it's still called Peking Man from the old previous way that they talked about the capital. So it's a museum there that has exhibits, and it highlights different aspects of pre-modern Homo sapiens sapien culture. Can we see the next slide? So there's several slides here that are coming up that are going to show that it wasn't just Homo sapiens sapiens that had the thing that makes humans distinct, that is culture. And this is tools that were found in China in association with Peking Man, dating way back to that early era, that were, you know, fashioned out of the natural resources and raw materials in that environment, bone and tooth and sticks and shells and rocks. Next slide, please. And there's evidence that, and this is, of course, a caricature of what Homo erectus might look like, but there was evidence that, definitive evidence, that they could and did use fire. However, it's still believed to this day that they only used fire found in nature in one way or another, after a lightning strike or, I don't know, a volcanic explosion, whatever causes fire in nature. They would capture some of that fire, tend it using kindling wood or other resources, and then use that fire to do things like cook meat, I'm guessing, and treat tools to harden them. the piece that got that is moving, but they didn't yet know how to make fire, but that came with Homo sapiens. So these are some of the culture traits that the earlier hominids that migrated throughout the old world out of Africa that I had neglected to talk about earlier, and shame on me. Well, and I'm now correcting that, and we know that Homo erectus preceded Homo sapiens into the old world out of Africa. And here I actually have dates from throughout Eurasia as much as 1.6 million years ago. So it's, I believe, that Homo erectus, the Beijing or Peking man, has a date of 750,000 years in China. But there's older finds of a million years or older in Europe, nearer, and the Middle East, so-called, the Asian area outside of Africa that are even earlier. So now what I want to do is... I think we have one more slide about out of Africa. There it is. We'll get a close up of that. We've seen it before. But let's take a closer look at it. So this map that I've shown you before, of course, which has dates throughout the old world and eventually into the new world and elsewhere, that is for, and it's kind of hard to see, only for Homo sapiens. This refers to the later flow of Homo sapiens into the old world and then beyond. Okay. So now let's consider having all of those complexities hopefully behind us. Let's consider the archaic Chinese state. And first thing we want to do is note some early civilizations on another map that's coming up here. And we'll get a close-up piece of this so we get a good look at it. And what are noted here in these four Old World River Valley cultures are the Egyptian territorial state that developed in the Nile, the Mesopotamian city-states of the so-called Middle East, which is really part of Asia. And then because my principal source, Trigger, says there's not enough information, he does not discuss India as an early civilization. That's still open to debate. But he does talk about the Xia and following Shang dynasties of China along the Yellow River, all of these being so-called, according to this map, Old World River Valley cultures, although they were very different. And as Trigger argues, this civilization includes Mesopotamia is distinct in all sorts of ways in terms of the rise of this civilization from that of nearby Egypt. Similarly, the Chinese civilization arose distinctively, that is, independently. Now, what makes them distinctive and independent? He argues that the cultures, the domesticates that arose in each of these places were substantially different, especially the technologies for dealing with those cultures were very different. In Mesopotamia, you had pot, well, agriculture out of the rivers, as opposed to Nile Valley flooding. This was some time in the case of China. You have different cultigens and different technologies than either of those early civilizations, as opposed to secondary civilizations, which effectively used largely the inventions and domesticates that had already been developed in these earlier civilizations, times like Rome. So, in the early Eurasian civilizations, two were territorial, Egypt and China, starting actually with the Xia, although there's not much, and that's spelled X-I-A, but I had a Chinese lesson today that's pronounced Xia. Starting with XIA, and then the succeeding Shang dynasty is where you get lots of archaeological evidence, encouraging is most of what we'll be looking at today. And then succeeding the Shang Dynasty is the Qin Dynasty, spelled Q-I-N. Can we see the next slide, please? And get a close-up of it. This is the Qin Dynasty, which succeeded the Shang. And what's crucial in this map is it shows a territorial state, the dark shaded area, in which there is a state capital here, and then a variety of provincial capitals, administrative secondary capitals, to govern the entire territorial state. Whereas the argument that Trigger presents and others, the Romans remained a city-state in which they went out and conquered other peoples and settled the Mexica and the Maya and taxed them and plundered them. Generally speaking, and it's a little fuzzy, but generally speaking, unlike China or Egypt, those other city-state civilizations did not homogenize with various tiers of administrative centers, a culture that was effectively forced enculturation or acculturation, forced enculturation or acculturation of the peoples they conquered. In the case of China, the emperor sent out administrators from the national capital, typically family members and other members of the royal family, to be more or less governors of various provinces, where they directly ruled over the people, forced the people, if necessary, to adopt all Chinese cultural traditions, including the language and the writing system, and in this way, made a territorial state. So hopefully this provides the good example that you've been waiting for, because up to now we've been looking at city-states, of what Bruce Trigger, the preeminent archaeologist, argues is the big difference between some early civilizations that were city-states, even though they had empires and tributary systems, versus a territorial state like China or Egypt or the Inca, which of course we don't deal with in this class either, in which the culture is effectively imposed upon all the peoples conquered to the best of the ability of the emperors and their administrators. Furthermore, the emperor will shift administrators from one province to another over time so that he doesn't allow them to get comfortable and to make alliances with local people that would allow for rebellions in different places. Instead, he rewards his administrators who are part of his royal family and by giving them these posts, but then periodically moves them from place to place so that their principal loyalty is supposed to remain with the emperor, and they're not supposed to gain their own ambitions and try to organize local armies to oppose and engage in conflict. Now, of course, that's the ideal. The reality is there was plenty of warfare, and there were a series of dynasties as a result of one dynasty being overturned by another and replaced by another. The crucial thing that most scholars agree is that the basic Chinese tradition started in these very early civilizations, the Sha, the Shang, Zhou, which is spelled C-H-O-A in English, but it's Zhou, pronounced Zhou, and the Qin, spelled Q-I-N on this map, that the culture was developed during these early dynasties and persisted largely intact until the fall of the last Chinese emperor in about 1910. So the next thing, and the Chinese state is, as is usual, tied to issues of evolution of human cultures increasing sizes and densities of population, forcing peoples that live in different areas to adopt new technologies so that with the natural resources and raw materials of their native indigenous environment, they can subsist and reproduce. By the time of the state, states are dependent on the domestication of various plants and or animals, and they have developed technologies that are very labor-intensive. People, if they could, would rather forage, stay foragers, than adopt domestication. But as the environments lose the ability to support the increase in size and density of population, people either starve or they have to adopt new technologies, including the domestication of plants and animals, so that ever more people can subsist and reproduce on lands that are filled with people and that all need food in order to do their thing. So let's consider human migration to, within, and from China. Can we have the next picture, please? Say the new world civilizations that I discussed a few weeks ago, of the Mexica and the Maya, the most labor-intensive agricultural production, in other words, the highest yields on the smallest parcels of land outside of Mesoamerica, were achieved in Asia, including, to begin with, in these early civilizations in China. Can we get a close-up of this, please? And what this shows is the very, here's a observer, a person standing in the countryside, the very labor-intensive terracing of hillsides, so that with dense populations, the lowlands are being completely farmed. People are moving into the hills and making terraces to allow them to grow crops, even on hillsides and into the mountains. This is very labor-intensive to shave these hillsides, to build up the walls that support these terraces, to fertilize these soils predominantly with manure from humans and, to the extent the Chinese did have it, also from animals, to keep up the fertility, to bring in irrigated water as needed, not to just wait for rainfall to occur, but to actually have ready sources of water. All of this takes a huge amount of labor. And people will only do these things if they don't have the choice of working less and still getting enough food. As states developed and as the upper classes do less and less or no agricultural production themselves, the farmers have to produce ever higher amounts of crops, not only to feed themselves and their family, but to pay in tribute or taxes, the so-called surplus that the people that don't farm, that aren't peasant farmers, demand in order to support them in their palaces and to feed all the people that create the luxury goods that we're becoming familiar with, that only full-time specialists can produce. Next slide, please. And can we get a close-up? And if we get a close-up look, we can see that unlike in the New World before the Spaniards came, this is from the Shang Dynasty, from about 1,000 or more years before the birth of Jesus Christ. The Chinese already had oxen, cows basically, and they had developed plows to till the soil, which allows the oxen to manure the soil, and the plows allow for greater productivity of human labor on the land that's produced there. So you had in China very high population sizes and densities, leading to the need for the domestication of plants and animals, and the very labor-intensive production of plants and animals, and only second in terms densities of population two civilizations like the Mexica. You might remember the Mexica lived on a completely man-made set of islands in Lake Texcoco that had a population of 1 million urban residents. And they didn't have these big draft animals, as they're called. They didn't have horses and cows. And everything was done with human labor. Well, the Chinese had the advantage of domesticated animals like this, which allowed them to produce high-yield crops to support relatively high population size densities and highly stratified societies with a very tiny, wealthy elite that then wants to show their status. Let me just mention here as well that several of the later dynasties, not the ones that we're discussing, but later dynasties, and there'll be some mentioned later in the lecture, of China that overthrew previous dynasties came from outside so-called China. And the most famous examples are the so-called Mongols, you know, the Attila the Hun and all those folks. Not only did they have conflicts with city-state civilizations in Europe, but they also invaded and conquered China. The interesting thing that emphasizes the territorial nature of the Chinese state is that although they came in and conquered the Chinese, they wound up the Mongols adopting Chinese culture. You know, they took over and overthrew the former dynasty, and they took over the palaces, and within no time at all, they were speaking Chinese dialects, they were using the Chinese language, they were using the early civilization's territorial state, even though they had come as outsiders, conquered the Chinese, and so Chinese civilization persisted. When outsiders came in and overturned individual rulers or dynasties. Territorial states, by definition, are both multi-ethnic and very assimilationist. So, for example, the United States is a territorial state. People come here from all over the world. And right now, something like 15% or so of the people living in the United States were born abroad. So we're very multi-ethnic, language being one marker of ethnicity, so-called race being another marker, religious difference being ethnic identity. But Americans demand that if you're going to be in the United States, well, you need to speak English. And so, although oftentimes the immigrants themselves have a hard time learning all the English that one might like, so they don't have an accent, so they don't have to resort to their native language. The children, 90% of the children of new immigrants that are raised in the United States, children raised in the United States, learn English, and usually by the third generation, the grandchildren of the immigrants can't even speak the language of their immigrant grandparents. So that's a multi-ethnic but highly assimilationist, hard to say, state. This was the case for all territorial states, for the Inca, the Egyptian, and the Chinese. You can come here. You can even sometimes overthrow our leaders. But eventually, we thought you were going to make you conform to the norms and standards of the traditional Chinese culture, and that's exactly what happened. Can we see the next bit, please? There were periodic invasions of the Chinese territorial state that were successful. Let's get a close-up of this one. This shows the extent of the Mongol Empire at its greatest. And you can see that it incorporates basically all of China, although the peoples came from this area, excuse me, we only have Beijing in there, that area, and they also went west and had great influences in the so-called Middle East, in civilizations that have developed in what became India, and even into the peninsula of Asia, as I called it, Europe. That that the Mongols took over vast territories in particular periods of time after the dynasties that we're going to be focusing on this week here. So let's now look at the basis of the Shang state. Why not the Shang, the first dynasty? Because there's virtually, the experts agree, virtually no archaeological evidence remaining of the Shang X5A state. There's some debate about some of the early ruins and sculptures, but basically the first state that we have an enormous amount of data is the Shang, and then it becomes greater when we look at the succeeding two dynasties. The Shang state, like early civilizations in Mesoamerican China, was based on domestication of plants and animals. And the first video that I'm going to show you, it's about 7 minutes long, is a film that was made in 1940 before China was overrun, so to speak, or conquered by the communists under Mao Zedong. Well, 1940 would have been when the Japanese were actually beginning to occupy. So let's look for the dates there and make sure. But what it's going to show you is going to show you from the mid-1900s, whatever it says it is, how the Chinese were living and how it was linked back in time to the early civilizations. And it focuses particularly on agriculture and on cultural developments based on agriculture, like the varied handicrafts that include bamboo, that becomes a major aspect of the cultivation in China that is used in a variety of things. So let's look at this first video clip, and then I'll review some of the important points with you afterwards.
Far inland from the eastern plains lies a valley of western China. Creeping the valley are lofty chains of mountains to the east, to the north, and to the west. For longer than written history has recorded the deeds of men, these mountains have loomed in silence over life in the valley below. When did men first settle here? When did they learn to till the soil? When did they first build temples in honor of their gods? When did they first entomb their dead in sepulchres of stone? These things no one knows with certainty. But this we know, the Chengdu royal city has sheltered its people for centuries, people who in time of peace have pursued their placid ways close to the friendly earth, people who have remained always, though dynasties rose and fell, people with an anchorage in the land. For centuries, the flow of seasons and the tides of growth have lent a mellow rhythm to their days. Theirs is a life rooted in a proud and ancient heritage, a life rooted in the soil of the ever-enduring earth. For unnumbered generations, farmers have plowed the fertile soil. After the harvest, the plow, and after the plow, the planting. This has been the cycle endlessly repeated. Through the ages, waters from the mountains have been fed to the fields of the valley, for here, irrigation is one of the ancient arts. Through untold years, the water has been led from nature's streams, through man-made channels, out to the planted fields. For centuries, the muscles of men have raised the water as needed for crops that have never failed. On a map of enduring slate, the great engineer Li Ping laid out the plan of the system 2,000 years ago. Clearly cut in timeless stone, every detail was skillfully traced by the ancient engineer. And the plan of 2,000 years ago still guides the flow of the waters to the fertile fields of the valley, where soil and water and men have met to provide a community's food. Nor does the water serve alone for raising the very crops. hills where grain is ground into flour beneath revolving stones. These may have their source of power in water-driven wheels. From valley fields, grain that is ground in the mills. Grain that may be hauled by hand with implements ancient in design. Generation after generation, the farmers of the valley have followed their age-old methods, producing grain from the fertile earth, grain for the farming household, grain for the shops of the city, where those who do not till the soil may buy the farmer's produce. From farmlands, too, come vegetables for many a busy market stall, vegetables of every kind in seemingly endless variety. Food from the soil for the people of the valley. Food that the earth has yielded through the years. But the earth yields more than food. One of its richest offerings is versatile bamboo. Growing straight and tall in the mild climate of the valley, down through the ages it has served the people well. Cut from luxuriant thickets, it provides a raw material of endlessly varied uses discovered long ago. Out of bamboo, chairs for the homes of the valley, chairs ingeniously fashioned by craftsmen like Lam Chin. Products, too, of his skillful hands are other articles for the home. Baskets and hammers and ladles, trays and mats and ropes, of bamboo, one and all. Out of bamboo, the chopsticks which every home must have. Thousands of pairs are shaped by hand by artisans like Ma Myung. And with chopsticks of bamboo, one may eat bamboo itself. Its roots provide a nourishing food long popular in the valley. Bamboo upon the banquet board and bamboo, too, in bridges, so vast is the range of uses devised by men of the valley. For more than 20 centuries, this torrent has been crossed by travelers, safely treading the narrow wooden walks supported by sturdy cables of sinewy bamboo, material that forms the length of grids the porter crosses and the shoulder pole he bears. Bamboo for the frames of sedan chairs. Bamboo for the pipes of tobacco that season a friendly chat. Chairs and chopsticks, baskets and bridges, shoulder poles and pipes. These are but a few of the uses devised by the valley people for bamboo from the soil. And from the earth, too, fine clay for the potter's art, an art that has brought to the valley one of its greatest glories. The craftsmanship of the potter of today is not of today alone. Its roots lie deep in traditional skill, perfected long ago. Through the classic dynasties of Tang and Song and Ling, the potter's wheels revolve. Then, as now, are beauty shaped with patient artistry. Honored craftsmen of the valley, too, are silversmiths of well-earned fame. Taking their place beside fellow artists working in wood and clay, these silver craftsmen work in metal refined from native ores. Whether incising with rarest skill their intricate designs, or deftly fusing with sureness of touch, delicate part to delicate part, theirs is a concentration born of a pride in their art, an art pursued through the ages. Yet older still is another art, the manufacture of silk. Silk secured from the filmy strands of delicate cuckoo. More than 4,000 years ago, so the legend claims, Chinese hands acquired the skill of weaving the silken thread. Certain it is that for centuries, shuttles have darted back and forth in the silk looms of the valley. Products of the weaver and his loom are the fabrics displayed in valley stores, rich and glossy today, even as long ago when sought by traders of far-off Europe. Thus is beauty created from threads of the fragile cocoons of silkworms that feed on the tender leaves of mulberry trees of the valley. As generations have come and gone, the modern streams have flowed on. But one day, 2,000 years...
I think one day, 2,000 years ago, is Buddhists don't say, well, we got the message. Part of the video HTTP title is People of 1940. So this video was made by the U.S. government in China in 1940 at a time when Japan was actually occupying ever larger chunks of China. And shortly before, we went to war with Japan in World War II with the bombing of Pearl Harbor. So it's really an amazing film in that it was made at all at the time that it was made, and that it, you know, although, of course, he goes too far because there has been enormous change and various influences from abroad through all these centuries up until the time when the video was made, it does show the basis of the early civilization continuing in terms of the dependence on a wide variety of agricultural commodities and other resources out of the soil. So you have you've got the silkworm that's essentially domesticated in the sense that it's fed on domesticated mulberry bushes. Silk was actually transplanted. Silk production was transplanted by the Spaniards to Mesoamerica among the Mixtec, one of the people that I lived with. In the late 1980s and early 1990s, they actually had a history during the colonial period of attempting to replicate the success, the long-standing success of producing silk in China. In the New World, it wasn't a big success, but they tried. And the bamboo, the silver, the milling of the grain into flour. This area of China, when we think of China, we're likely to think of rice. In the same way that when I think of lions in Rome, I think of Christians, although preceding that. Or when I think of crucifixion, I think of Romans and Christians. But crucifixion was actually borrowed from the Carthaginians, their longtime enemy, by the Romans. Well, I think of rice in the case of China. But in Western China, and more or less Northern China, rice is a tropical lowland wet cultivation, and in this area, it was more likely that they grew wheat and barley and other staples that we usually more associate with Europe and Western Europe, Central Europe, Eastern Europe. Actually, they had that here in China as well. And you can get a sense for, you know, the various aspects of the agrarian base that are still evident in the 1940 video, and how there are people, they mention, that don't produce food themselves. These are the city dwellers who are specialists, the rulers who administer the area. And so you get some sense for what is still fundamentally an agricultural society in 1940, in which agriculture is depended on by all, but not all produce agriculture. I want to talk about the tea complex, and after I talk about the tea complex, before we look at the luxury goods of the Shang society, we'll take the public service announcement video break. So first, let's look at the next slide of tea culture in China, and let's get a close-up of this, please. This is crucial to the later history of China. Unlike America, in China and later in other parts of the world, it was tea, which is in these baskets here, and being drunk at these tables at this tea house in a very elaborate culture that the Chinese developed. It was tea that was the principal beverage of choice, whereas we use coffee as a stimulant in the United States. In other places of the world, and of course we don't need to think any further than the British, tea is at least as, if not more, preferred traditionally and even currently than is coffee. And tea was indigenous to China and adjacent regions of Asia. And the European emperor, the Chinese emperors determined the terms of trade with outsiders. The reason why the Mongols have relationships with China is that the Mongols lived outside of the agrarian regions and they were pastoralists in what is now Mongolia and other areas of the steppes. They couldn't grow crops, but they raised animals. And they would bring the animals to the agricultural regions of China and trade animal products, milk, beef, blood, whatever the case might be, to the Chinese in exchange for the plants the Chinese grew. Now and then, the emperor of China always tried to control the terms of trade. So he would say how much meat the Mongols had to pay to get a certain amount of agricultural goods. Sometimes he would even say, "Oh, we don't like the terms of trade you're offering," and he would close Chinese exports or trade with the Mongols. Several of the major Mongol invasions of China were a result of the Mongols getting mad when the Chinese emperor tried to determine the terms of trade between the two peoples or closed off trade with the outside. The Chinese culture is seen largely by traditional scholarship as insular, in which the emperor tries to micromanage society in order to keep intact in a conservative way, just like the Senate and the councils and emperors of Rome are conservative, to maintain his control over the wealth of the society and to determine who and at what cost could gain access to some of that wealth. Well, eventually the British developed basically an addiction to this tea. And by then, they had expanded their own empire to include much of what had been the Indus Valley of India, where, among other things, they produced huge quantities of opium at a relatively cheap price. And they wanted to trade opium with the Chinese for, among other things, tea. And the Chinese emperor said, "No thanks, we don't want highly addictive drugs that destroy cultures and peoples and families in China. We don't want your opium. If you want our goods, you have to pay what we say and with the goods that we want." And mostly what the Chinese emperor wanted was the gold and silver, which had been mined primarily in the New World. And so he was demanding, effectively, mineral wealth, or the equivalent of cold cash for his tea. Here the English wanted, instead, to trade opium, a highly addictive drug. You all probably know that's what heroin and Oxycontin and Vicodin are all based on, is opium. And so, eventually, the English declared war on China for the sole purpose of forcing the Chinese emperor to back down and accept opium for the goods that the English wanted, especially this tea. So, and hence the beginning of the Opium War. Talking about a war on drugs, huh? So now we're going to take our short break, and when we come back, we'll get to the luxury goods produced by the Shang and succeeding dynasties that show the evidence for the elites in those early civilizations.
Hey, what's up? I'm Nicole Harris.
And I'm Shayna. You guys are watching University TV.
Today we're at California State University, Dominguez Hill,
home of the Suarez.
Join us on our campus tour. The Parklife Center on the Cal State Dominguez campus sits on 346 acres, providing plenty of places to stay or lounge outside and enjoy the California weather. And all buildings are only a short walking distance from one another. You'll also find pedestrian paths lined by eucalyptus or other shade trees.
known as the Colorado Hill, the hymn speaks to the use of the terrain. Many buildings built at varied elevations. The hymn is made only to set the floor in most buildings, and bridge walkways provide a seamless connection.
So first, we need to list why the seamless this is
University enrolls about 12,000 students per semester. It is one of the most ethnically and culturally rich student bodies in the U.S. The number one ethnic group on campus is the majority. The student body is 70% female to 30% male.
Well, after graduating, I had an opposite position in a school, and I decided to come here. I want to be a teacher, and customer sees how the best teaching program is for teacher prevention.
So far, students have a specific GPA requirement. It corresponds with their SAT or ACT score. Higher your GPA, the less weight you put on the score. The lower the GPA, the stronger that weight needs to be.
Students with GPAs below 2.0 are not eligible for admission.
For California residents, the average full-time GPA at university is $3,400, not including the cost of books or housing. All state students pay about $400 extra per unit. The university offers many financial aid options, including scholarships and grants.
Cal State's biggest institutions include 45 bachelor's, 21 master's degrees, and 10 teaching credential certificate programs.
We are planning to find many underwater climate investigations, how specifically the development algorithms the teachers rely to make to identify ship wreckage, explosives, and so forth.
Some of the students' favorite majors include global studies, business administration, digital media arts, child development, and nursing.
Want to work in television or the motion picture and music industries? Cal State Davis has a digital media arts program successfully prepares students for careers in those fields.
The legend holds true. There's a ghost in every theater. The Dominguez Hill spirit comes to every play, opens the elevator doors, and wishes the cast good luck.
The university also has the largest master's degree program in conflict resolution and peacebuilding. Plus, the Orthotics and Prosthetics program is one of only 7 such programs in the nation.
With 687 faculty members, the university has a student-faculty ratio of 23-1.
The university has 11 men's and women's girls athletic teams, including an NCAA Division II level.
The girls hold 23 conference titles and 3 national championships.
Our students work at Cal State campuses, unlike most college residence halls or dormitories. The complex consists of 22 two-story buildings with 1, 2, and 3 bedroom furnished apartments, all with full kitchens. The apartments were originally built to house athletes for the 1984 Summer Olympics.
I do currently live in Campus Housing, and it's a nice experience. I don't have mom there to tell me what to do, but also it gives me the opportunity to interact with people on a more intimate setting. Students can select from 60 student groups to join or participate in, from cultural and special interest organizations to professional service and honor society groups. There are also 5 fraternities and 8 sororities on campus, some of whose origins have Latino or African American beginnings.
There's a lot of students who get involved. They do not seek involvement in clubs and organizations, schools, or fraternities. But we love the staff to be looking at adult alternative.
Addicted to reality TV? Well, here's your reason to get off the couch. The Associate Students Incorporated put activities together for the students every year. Today, the Amazing Race.
Danny Rissett, a pianist composer who has worked with people like Herbie Hancock and Prince. Missy Nash, an actress whose selection credits include Reno 911 and Clean House. And John Langley, the home theater and executive producer of classically entertaining costs.
The number for summer is in Castle Hills will be home. Yes, it is a home.
If you're looking for a friendly student from this university where you won't get lost and it seems like everyone knows your name, be sure to check out Cal State Dominguez Hills in the heart of beautiful Southern California.
Thanks for joining us here in Carson, California, on our campus tour of California State University.
Juan Ying, welcome back to the second half of our discussion of archaic China. This is the Anthropology 3 through 6 course, Comparative Sociopolitical Systems. And we left off with kind of a downer, the discussion of the later Opium War, which eventually led to the dismemberment and final fall of the long-lasting Chinese empire civilization, territorial state, in about 1910. Remember that you're always free to write in a question or call in at 800-339-1193. An email has come in to me. The Chinese government made a movie about the Opium Wars and how it was an extension of the British free trade system. Well, you know, this is actually one of the major points that I'll be making, especially in the second half of the semester, that what we call free trade was once called gunboat diplomacy, or forcing open the doors of other nations. And various Western nations, especially in Western Europe and the United States, actually went places and told people, say, we don't care how you do things. If you don't do A, B, and C, then we're going to respond in X, Y, and Z ways, which included, above all else, violence. And in order to promote free, what I prefer to call forced trade, to open up new markets through force of arms if necessary, and indeed the Opium War is the classic case of that, not just as far as the Chinese government is concerned, but I believe the scholarly literature basically recognizes that capitalism was largely spread through imperialism, colonialism, and that capitalism has its origins in the colonization, the imperialistic colonialization of an entire globe after or around 1500 AD. So going back to 1500 BC, let's look at some luxury goods of the Shah. The Shang dynasty, which is the second dynasty, and demonstrates their control, as far back as 3000 BC, the control of a tiny elite over the bulk of the population. And here you have, over my shoulder here, what was called the heart of the Shang civilization, one of the contemporary provinces of China, Henan. Henan province. And since that shaded area is where the Shang dynasty began and where its earliest capital cities were, the next two slides show, I don't even know if they're reconstructions of ruins, but this is contemporary depictions of the center of the Shang civilization. Over my shoulder here, can we get a quick close-up of this, followed by the next picture afterwards? You can see you've got some pretty fancy construction here. You've got full-time specialists producing these palaces, these courtyards that are exhibited here. The next photo, and you can just do a close-up. There you go. I guess I'm assuming this is a temple in the Pagoda style, and you've got the dragons and the motifs, the tilted roofs, that China is so famous for. Next picture, please. This, they tell me, from the website of the museum, the documents, Shang Society, this is the earliest depiction of slavery. And so it's believed that it was in the Shang Dynasty as long as 3,000 years BC that slavery first arose anywhere in the world. It didn't give depiction, and I didn't go into the details why these stylized elephants that are holding the arms of this human-looking individual document slavery, but this is the argument that they give there. The next slide, please. Let's get a close-up of this. This is a jade burial suit for the elite. And so what they've done here is fashioned clothing out of that stone known as jade, and they put the dead bodies of the elite, presumably the emperors and other very powerful members of this family, inside these suits for burial. So you can imagine the effort that goes into that sort of luxury good. Next slide, please. And let's get a close-up. Believe it or not, this is a warrior's bronze battle axe. So this is the blade down here, and presumably the shaft was, attached there. And these warriors obviously had extremely fancy weaponry at their disposal. I don't know what the details of this, that information was readily available, whether this is a stylized face of the emperor or whether it's one of the gods. But the warriors, the emperor's army, carried these fancy bronze battle axes in battle. And some of you know that bronzing is a very complex metallurgy that was highly developed in ancient China. And some of the most beautiful objects of bronze are found in early Chinese civilization. Next slide, please. Here is a cooking pot. Now, the peasants knew this is a bronze cooking pot used either by the emperor and his family or maybe the religious leadership, if there's any difference between the two. Highly ornamental, very labor-intensive, produced by specialists with all kinds of decorations on it that may, for all I know, include calligraphy that that explains the history of that era or the religious beliefs. Next slide, please. And here's another bronze cooking pot. I believe it's another cooking pot. And again, you can see heavily stylized, very fancy. You need full-time specialists to produce these goods. Now we're going to skip the succeeding after the Shang to the Zhou, spelled Z-H-O-A dynasty. And we're going to skip that, and we're going to look at the short-lived Qin dynasty, spelled Q-I-N, and we had the map of the territorial state of the Qin dynasty, because we want to look at the most amazing evidence of elite burials. And so if we could have the next slide behind me, please. There's going to be one coming up here. It's going to show some sort of worker working for an archaeologist cleaning the terracotta sculptures that are life-size, of which I don't remember for sure. There's a video clip that will give us more details. Hundreds, if not thousands, of various strata of society are represented in this elite burial. So you've got the emperor and his royal family. You've got various high officials. You have tax collectors. And you have soldiers and horses and all kinds of things created out of terracotta, which I'm assuming is some sort of pottery style sort of thing, and then buried in the ground along with the emperor at his death, in which he and several of his wives and concubines were buried together, they being killed, human sacrifices basically, to go on with him in his journey. Can we get a close-up of this? We'll see it in a short video clip, and let's just get a close-up to get an idea, because you can see that they're basically life-size, because you've got workers cleaning these up in the trenches where they were discovered. And this shows the immense wealth and power of the tiny elite and the resources that they command. And so now we're going to show a short video clip, and I'm going to give you the briefest of previews by just saying it's only a minute or so long, a minute and a half long. It's from the BBC at the time that these ruins were initially announced, before the full extent of the findings were discovered. And I have available for my students a 50-minute video which goes into great detail later of the findings of this particular place. So let's look at this news brief video from the BBC of this finding of the Shin Empire.
Warriors. This terracotta army has been eaten throughout thousands of years. It's called the Shin Emperor wanted them to be built and buried alongside his tomb here in Shaanxi Province's Lingtong County. They were designed to protect him in the afterlife. This vast network was discovered by an accident by a group of farmers stumbled across them while digging a well. Since then, they've been gracing galleries and delighting audiences all over the world. It's the first time in 20 years that archaeologists have looked back into these pits. They've spent the last 2 decades developing better methods for preserving the original colors of these ancient warriors. Still, it's a painstaking task. This place is about the size of a football pitch and home to around 6,000 warriors. These excavations are expected to take up to 5 years, but for them it's worth it. It's every day they're piecing together the cost.
Wow, 6,000 warriors at that early day when that video was made. And later video shows even more. I didn't remember the details now. This is kind of the problem of talking about human cultures. The evidence from early civilizations that is left behind is largely the evidence of what the elites of those civilizations did. And they did it by having control over the vast bulk of the population and by finding ways of effectively forcing the most people in this territorial state, along with those who they might have conquered or had conflicts with, and those they might have traded with, to garner agricultural wealth in order to free an increasing number of people from farming to produce the luxury goods, the burial wealth, all the other things. And we now finally go, oh, wasn't that marvelous and wonderful? Well, it was really marvelous and wonderful. The peasant farmers who had to bear the enormous taxation burdens. I mean, we hear about nowadays, oh, we don't want to raise taxes, let's get the public educational system instead. The taxes in some of those early civilizations could have been up to or more than 50% of what the farmers grew. And in many cases, the farmers went without a good diet, because if they didn't provide the amount of taxes that the elite demanded, well, then they would be punished, including with, you know, imprisonment or death. And so, although it's amazing and beautiful to look at pyramids and temples and bronze objects, we have to try to not only think about the tiny elite men that ran the society and their women, but the bulk of the populations that had to endure great hardship in order to allow a highly stratified society to develop in which the majority of the wealth flowed upwards for the benefit of relatively few. And to honor those that did the hard work of the longer view clip that we saw earlier, plowing the land, planting the domesticants, harvesting and paddling the water wheel and milling the flour, all of those things, we want to keep in mind those people because really, we ourselves in our society are more like those people. We are the workers that depend on wages or salaries. Very few of you out there are part of the elite who benefit primarily from the work of others. And so we want to kind of keep that in mind as we're wowed by these amazing archaeological finds. They're supposed to be markers for and reminders for highly stratified societies in which a relatively tiny elite has found ways of controlling the vast bulk of the population. In the second half of the semester, when we look at especially migration to the U.S., we'll see how the United States has managed to benefit inordinately from the hard work and labor of others from China, Italy, and Mexico, the two studies that we look at there. So with that in mind, let's look at our next picture to look at more elite objects. Can we get a close-up of this? This was labeled as a tomb demon. This is supposed to scare people away, presumably, from the riches held in the tomb. This is some kind of monster or god of the afterlife, kind of a gargoyle kind of creature with a spiny back and huge teeth, kind of looks like a mix of a cat and a, I don't know what, dinosaur. Next slide, please. Here you see elite members of the Xin dynasty playing. And what are they playing? They're playing chess. So chess is a very ancient game. And what is it a game of? It's a game of war. Next slide, please. Close up, please. Here's one of the chess pieces that my producers found for us to look at. And basically, what do you have here? You have a mounted warrior. And chess is a game of conquest in which two armies face off against each other, and in which strategy is used to determine a winner and a loser. And one king overturning and checkmating another king. Next slide, please. Here's more bronze objects, urns that might have held food and or water that were used by the elite. Next slide, please. And this shows, just to remind you, that, you know, when we think of China today, it's not the same as the Shang dynasty. The extent of the Shang dynasty is here, whereas, of course, contemporary China is here. And what's interesting to me is that Tibet, I don't know the exact contours, is about one-third of the territorial mass of contemporary China. Small wonder that China invaded Tibet in the 1950s, took it over, and refuses to allow Tibet autonomy, let alone independence. Because if China were to let Tibet go, the Chinese state would shrink territory-wise by about a third its total size. Next slide, please. This is Confucius, and Confucius is dated back to the Shang dynasty era. And Confucius was one of several very famous kind of philosopher scholars who is now credited at helping to shape Chinese civilization. And out of Confucianism, among other things, came the idea of a meritocracy in which the smartest people of the empire, not just the royal family, but the smartest people could get advanced educations and come into the empire and fill the various bureaucratic structures that kept the empire running. And so China is like the earliest case of a meritocracy, where people could gain upward mobility not just by being soldiers and potentially sacrificing themselves at war with the enemies of the state, like the Mexica. Some Mexica gained upward mobility by being soldiers in Mesoamerica, but by brain power. And so China has this ancient tradition of study of knowledge and respect for education, which of course is now coming in good stead amongst the immigrant population from Asia to the United States. Unlike the Latino population or other ethnic minorities in the U.S., Asian immigrants and their families, on average, have higher per capita incomes than white citizens of the United States, largely because much, not all, but much of the immigration from different countries in Asia comes from the more educated classes coming here to try to get ahead, coming with professions, coming here with talents and knowledge. And it all goes back to Confucius and how that was built into the earliest civilizations, this meritocracy of respecting knowledge and allowing education for the most talented individuals from every station in society. Not that everybody got a public education, but that the elite would be on the lookout for individuals in the general population at young ages that showed promise, that showed abilities, that showed talent, and then provided education to them. Next slide. This is the riches of the Orient. I've already alluded to this when I talked about the Opium War. The Chinese Empire was considered the richest empire in the history of the world, with all sorts of wonderful wealth inside that empire, based on an agrarian base from which tea, a highly desired commodity, and many other spices were highly desired in far-flung parts of the old world. And so over time, people like Marco Polo here left city-states in places like Italy and traveled on what became known as the Silk Road, the trade route through the so-called Middle East, near Asia, to India and beyond to China, where Marco Polo spent, 17 years, I don't remember the exact amount of time, documenting the wealth of China. And people like Marco Polo made the elites emerging in late Middle Ages and then early Renaissance Europe aware of the fact of this great wealth that was in the Orient. And the things that Marco Polo and other traders brought with them, the trade along the Silk Route, became a major way by which Europe emerged out of the immiseration of at least the late Dark Ages, the Middle Ages, and the return of new sea states like Venice and Florence were based upon these trading routes that were especially targeting China. But as I mentioned earlier, the Chinese emperor had a powerful territorial state, great military control over his region. He determined the terms of trade. Even worse, from the point of view of Europeans, they had to pass through lands occupied by other peoples along the Silk Route and pay taxes for the right to go along the Silk Route, to go from Europe overland to eventually India and China and other areas where there was wealth. And over time, of course, a large portion of that area that they had to pass through became dominated by Islam practicing peoples of the so-called Middle East, and who were seen as inferior because they were considered, well, they were non-Christians. They believed that there was a prophet after Jesus Christ, the prophet Muhammad, who provided them with a book different than the New Testament. And so there was this enormous cultural difference that Europeans who wanted to trade with the Orient had to deal with all along the Silk Route. This eventually led Europeans like the Italian Columbus, who's from Italy, to look for a sponsor to seek routes to the Orient over sea rather than over land. And of course, a variety of explorers went out from the Mediterranean and the Atlantic Ocean along the coast of Africa, where they became more involved with African peoples and found that they could, for relatively cheap prices, buy black slaves. And going that way, and eventually Columbus going across the Atlantic to where he believed the Indians had to exist on the other side of the Atlantic. And when he ran into the New World, calling it the Indies and calling the peoples Indians, or Indios in Spanish, the language of his sponsor, the King and Queen of Spain, all of this beginning reemergence of that little tiny peninsula on the western end, so to speak, is it the western end? Turn around in here. On the end of Asia, I guess it's the eastern end of Asia, that we call Europe, was first generated and stimulated by a desire of Europeans to trade with and obtain the riches that especially came from this ancient civilization that was China. And Marco Polo, being a kind of the major popularizer in terms of his long stay there, and the books or journals or whatever it was that he wrote, and the trade that he stimulated during, along with his uncle during the years that he was there, led eventually to this so-called Age of Discovery, the Europeans blundering into the New World peoples, and the beginning of what I call Dr. K's, I call myself for sure, the three isms, imperialism, colonialism, and capitalism, that all emerged out of the desires of Europeans to tap into the wealth that was far away and costly to find, and looking for more efficacious ways of obtaining those riches by, instead of going along the Silk Road overland, through a lot of different populations that were taxing them and maybe even raiding them and taking away the trade goods, trying to find a sea route leading to the incorporation of Africa into the European productive process via the goods found in Africa and the slaves that can be gained there, and then the New World and the enormous wealth that was discovered in the New World, especially in the forms of gold and silver of the New World, that basically funded the empire wars between Portugal and Spain, between them and the Dutch and the English, and that eventually led to the establishment of worldwide empires, like the English Empire, upon which the sun once upon a time never set. All of this comes into motion because of an agricultural commodity like tea and other spices that are agricultural commodities, or silk, which is a byproduct of raising worms on mulberry bushes and things like that. So, Marco Polo, the wealth of China, fosters the growth of the Silk Road, increases grievances, which lead to the Crusades. One of the main things Europeans that stimulated the Crusades is the traders were saying, hey, we have to deal with all these Islamic infidels, and they tax us, and we need to push them aside, and we need to take over the Silk Road and make it safe for our traders to go back and forth. And besides, the Holy Land is there, and that's where Jesus was born. And how can we let that happen? And the desires to find a sea route and all the other things I talked about here. So, what are the main points that I wanted us to learn from this session tonight, this show tonight? What I try to do is review and elaborate on a variety of aspects of the first, more or less, four dynasties of ancient, archaic, early civilization, China. And I've argued that it contrasts in a number of ways from the city-state empires of Mesoamerica, which were early civilizations and city-states, and contrasts with the Roman city-state and the tributary system that they established during the period that we discussed last week. And so, you know, there are similarities. What are some of the similarities? The base of agrarian wealth for early civilizations, the usurpation of that agrarian wealth by a tiny elite that then can live very lavish lifestyles far removed from the majority of their subjects, let alone from many of the conquest victims as their states grow over time and their tributary systems get extended. You have conflicts which lead to individual dynasties being overthrown, even by foreigners, like the Mongols. And yet the Mongols, because it's a territorial state, instead of just destroying and plundering and imposing their culture on the Chinese, they wind up acculturating to Chinese civilization and becoming effectively Chinese in their cultural traditions over time. So China has an enormous amount of internal conflict, internal migration, migration from outside, whether it be Europeans later in terms of trade or the Mongols that were residing in pastoral economic modes near these agrarian peoples. You've got this constant tumult, and yet for thousands of years, Chinese civilization persists even as individual dynasties rise and fall. I discussed the four earliest known Chinese dynasties that existed from thousands of years B.C. until about 200 years B.C. to be succeeded by a variety of other dynasties, some of which are headed by initially Mongols who become acculturated. And that together, these four dynasties provided for the fundamental basis of what became known as Chinese civilization that persisted for thousands of years until about 1910, when it all finally fell apart with the invasions of various colonial nations, like the U.S., like Japan, like the British, the Portuguese, and others who came in, took pieces of the Chinese territorial state, made a trading post, used gunboat diplomacy to determine the terms of trade, and eventually popular discontent with the Chinese emperor's ability to defend his territorial state, along with the pressures of the outsiders that to The Last Emperor, a great movie by one of my favorite Italian directors, although it's made in Hollywood and in English, The Last Emperor by Bernardo Bertolucci. Not his best movie, but still a great movie that you can see about the fall of the last of the Chinese emperors, the eunuchs, all that cool stuff. So these things were reviewed. Despite the long dynastic period of time that's covered by the four first dynasties and the continuing dynasties through into the 1900s AD, there is enormous dynastic tensions, conflicts, successions, lots of migration into China to trade, to live agrarian lives, to try to conquer the Chinese and displace them. lots of migration within China, the filling up of the agrarian valley lowlands, leading to farming on the hillsides, the terraces, lots of mixture, lots of involvement in this multi-ethnic state with a strong impetus for assimilation to a basic Chinese culture. Despite the scholarly insistence that you saw in the long video of the enduring Chinese civilization, there's lots of conflict, lots of warfare, lots of instability. Then in line with the clip set from 1940, plenty of times when there was famines, when the crops failed, or the people were taxed so much that they starved, etc. The territorial form of the Chinese state was stronger than that of city states. The territorial state governed from the administrative capital in which the emperor puts his people into positions in all the areas that he conquers, moves them around over time, allows for Confucian mobility for the best capable and most loyal to obtain and maintain posts. The territorial state has more stability than city states. Go out and plunder, create lots of enemies. And like in the case of the Mexica, once the Spaniards come, they pick up all sorts of allies from other city states and wipe them out. So there's constant bloodshed, intrigue, and warfare, but longer stability nonetheless. We will return to the case of China in week 9, if I've got my weeks right now, when we'll look at case studies from the east coast of China, and particularly migration to the U.S. in the past up to the present, including illegally. We'll consider the effects of Western imperialism and colonialization on the decline and collapse of imperial China, and we'll look at how, in the contemporary period, Chinese culture has affected the United States through Chinese migration. Next week, we're going to review the first 5 weeks. We're going to systematically compare the things that we've discussed in these first 5 weeks. We're going to look again in review at Mesoamerica, Rome, and ancient China so that we can understand causes and consequences of migration, city versus territorial state, the relative instability of all states relative to other kinds of socio-political systems. Coercion and violence will focus on particularly as what the elite needs to keep things going. And so, let's see if I can get this right. Xia Zhou Jian, see you all next week when we come back and we look at comparatively the three archaic states that we studied in the last 5 weeks.